You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Politics of the Middle East, Political Science 342. This is our second meeting for this semester, and we are today discussing current events in the Middle East, specifically in Syria, the end of the summit to the Geneva II. We are also discussing the Tunisian politics with the Tunisian Assembly voting overwhelmingly for a constitution that many view as progressist and one of a kind in the region. And finally, we shift we stay in Northern Africa, shifting to Egypt, where there has been some demonstrations, violence continues there. And we'll talk there about what's happening to the Muslim Brotherhood. And if we have time, just for you to know, President Barack Obama is visiting Saudi Arabia in March. And there is talk in the Middle East that he's going to mend ties between the Saudis and the Americans, because apparently President Barack Obama is not happy with how the relationship between the Saudis and the Americans have deteriorated to the level they have. And so he's there to discuss those relationships. This is a live and online program, which means that throughout the lecture, we are going to review the current events in the Middle East. And we expect you to send us a message, a text that would be with a cell phone, but an email. You can reach us by dialing or emailing us on that account, or you could call us on an 800 number, which also appears on the screen. And you could express a comment, you could ask a question, and we'll be more than happy to help you to find an answer for you. Hopefully we'll have the answers. But the topics of today then is Syria, Tunisia, Egypt, and President Barack Obama's visit or a scheduled visit to Saudi Arabia. That will set us for next week discussion on the American foreign policy in the Middle East. Let's begin with the Syrian negotiations, which ended last week, I believe around Saturday. And those negotiations ended after a few days of hard work. There were a lot of people who were unhappy with how the negotiations were going. They were, to say the least, difficult negotiations. But at the end of it, we have a discrepancy. There is a Los Angeles Times that described the conclusions of this conference as Los Angeles Times description, mute optimism. The Los Angeles Times felt that there were some that the Geneva conference led to something, that the fact that people were talking was an improvement. True. But the region newspapers and media describe it differently. They basically said that this was a waste of time, a waste of effort. And the Gulf News, for example, blamed the Syrian regime for not taking this negotiation seriously. And the Saudi newspaper, Al-Sharq Al-Awsat, which is owned and financed by the Saudi government, Royal Kingdom, wrote an editorial stating that McCain, Senator McCain, was right in attacking this conference and for not supporting it. And so they wrote the whole article vindicating or telling us that, well, McCain was right And so this conference was a waste of time. So the point in all of this is that there is this discrepancy between what we in the West have sort of come to view this conference in a way, in a sense, we are satisfied with the fact that they are talking. In the region, they wanted more. They wanted people to be more serious. So we are going to continue talking with this. There is a clip that I'd like you to see, and it will set us sort of, give us a picture of how the negotiation went. When we come back, we'll talk more about it. And please call us if you have a question on the Syrian conflict. And the question perhaps for you is, where do you see Syria going? Now that the Geneva II is finished, there is a meeting next week, but do you see that these negotiations are worth having? Please watch.
Or the opposition delegations in Geneva for the Syria peace talks. That's according to joint UN Arab League envoy Lakhdar Brahimi, who held a press conference on Thursday after another long day of talks. Now, Mr. Brahimi talked extensively about the situation in Homs and talked about how upsetting it was that aid still wasn't able to be delivered to residents suffering in Homs. He said that although it was upsetting, that negotiations were still ongoing to try to give relief to those people inside Homs, which has been besieged for 600 days. He also talked during this press conference about how some food packets, about 600, had reached residents of the Yarmouk Palestinian refugee camp, where reports of starvation had been emerging in recent weeks. Now, also on Thursday, an extensive report by Human Rights Watch alleges that the Syrian government demolished thousands of homes unlawfully in 1 year in strongholds of the opposition in Hama and Damascus. Now, the report contains satellite photos showing the level of destruction in Syria. This first shot from February of last year, it shows dozens of high-rise residential and commercial buildings in the Meza area, a suburb of Damascus. Here's the same area in July of 2013. Many of the buildings are now completely demolished. Here's a different neighborhood in Damascus from July 2012. Look closely and you can see a six-story residential building is on fire, likely from artillery shelling. Now, the same area from September 2012. Again, many of the buildings now leveled by explosions. And here's a look at a neighborhood in the city of Hama from September 2012. And the same area just a month later, this satellite photo from October 2012, the neighborhood has been completely demolished. Now, Human Rights Watch says that pro-government media and some Syrian officials have stated that, in fact, this was some sort of urban planning scheme and that it was buildings that were not up to code that had been demolished. Human Rights Watch, though, states that it was only in opposition strongholds that these buildings were demolished and that this was unlawful. Mohammed Jamjoum, CNN, Beirut.
Welcome back to Castel Dominguez Hills. That was a clip from CNN, from Beirut, the capital of Lebanon, showing the impact or the destruction of Syria, specifically the cities of Homs and Hama. And you could see how the buildings were leveled, the ground, how the humanitarian issue is horrific in that country. And when there was a slight of hope in Geneva too, when the parties met to try to reach a political solution to their conflict. When the first day, they actually sat down together and talked about the humanitarian issue, specifically the city of Homs. The parties sensed that it was in their best interest to move forward and to try to agree on the basic on this basic humanitarian issue. And everybody thought this is a good start. And what we are going to see is they reach a good solution, a solution that will be helpful for the next stage. And there was a discussion about building what they call mutual confidence measures, namely that the idea is that the two parties will negotiate, and as they negotiate, they will know each other, and as they will know each other, it will be easier for them to get to an agreement. But days later, that optimism, that encouragement that we saw the first day disappeared. And at the end of the summit, Gulf News, for example, wrote in its editorial that the two parties failed to reach even a small agreement about an important issue such as the humanitarian issue. So it's a disaster, and the two parties contributed, failed to even use it and think about the Syrian people and what's happening to the people in Homs and other parties. And we haven't even talked about the refugees, the millions of people are suffering from the effect of the civil war, or rightly should call it a war against the civilian. The civilians are really trapped in the middle, trapped between a faction of the government and another faction of the opposition. This is not to suggest that one side is right and the other is wrong, but the fact is the civilians are in the middle, and it is a war against the civilian more than a civil war. I see we have a phone call, so I'm going to take the phone call, and when we come back, we'll continue this conversation. Michael, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Dr. Salhi. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing all right. Good to call. What's happening?
I just had a question, and I wanted to kind of get your opinion on something.
Okay.
Why do you think the Syrian government are kind of behind in destroying or getting rid of the chemical weapons? What they already kind of committed with the disarmament contract with the Americans, that they were trying to get rid of the weapons, but they've really been dragging their feet.
So the question, Michael, is that why are they trying to get rid of the chemical weapons?
Yeah, like why is it taking them so long to destroy them? I mean, they're already behind in their scheduled date.
It's the too long to destroy them. It can be a separate question. Thank you, Michael. Please keep watching, and we'll see you in class on Thursday. Okay. That's the number you could call us if you have a question. And the theory about chemical weapons, this is very, very interesting. Okay. Up to maybe the massacre that we've seen where the Americans and the British used to rally popular support to intervene. Remember a month ago, maybe now less than a year or so, when the opposition provided evidence that the Syrian government was using chemical weapons against its own people. Well, the British took that and presented as an evidence a justification for intervening. Well, the British Parliament said, no, we are not going to intervene. This is a conflict that we don't want to deal with. Now, the Americans, the same thing. But just in the context, and Michael is right, in the middle of this, when this was happening, the Syrian said, well, you know, I'm ready to get rid of my nuclear weapons, my chemical weapons. And it was the Russian foreign minister that suggested that what if the Syrians agree to give up their chemical weapons, would that be something to look for? And indeed, that's what happened. But why would the Syrian regime take that position? I think it's one of the cleverest position that they can have. It's a shrewd position. It shows a lot of political maturity. Because what happened, and I believe this, when you look at it from an analytical perspective, it is highly likely that the Syrian government did not use the chemical weapon for obvious reason. They had other ways, other power to use the planes, and they were also ahead of the game more than anything else. The area when it happened, it was under their control, and it was not sort of expected. It would not be expected for them to use it. That aside, and you just saw the 800 number that you could call us if you have a question, and that's the email if you want to send us a comment. But here what happened. Now, there is this area where, and now we know the chemical weapons that were used. The Syrian regime says, I didn't use it. Well, if they didn't use it and truly didn't use it, that means the opposition has nuclear chemical weapons. Sorry for the confusion. Didn't have chemical weapons. If it's proven, If they believe that the opposition has chemical weapon, that means that the opposition has a leverage against the Syrian regime, that now they have something that he could use against them and then tip the balance of power inside Syria for them. It's as if, you know, you say, I don't have nuclear weapon, and then I find out that you use it down there, and because I didn't use it, so you have it. So by proposing, by coming out and said, look, I am going to, that's it. I'm going to give you all the weapons I have, and I'm not going to use them again. What it did, it removed the Syrian regime, removed the issue of the chemical weapons from any kind of gaming or political struggle inside Syria. So now the chemical weapons, and if the Syrian opposition has them, were not going to be used as a leverage in any kind of negotiations. And when you negotiate with, and the enemy knows that you have chemical weapons, you're negotiating most likely from a powers of strength. So the opposition, if it used it, it sent a right signal to the Syrian regime that, look, wait, the opposition has the chemical weapons, and if they have it, that means they have the leverage. They can negotiate, they can be strong, they can negotiate from a position of strength with us. This is why what they did is that they came out and said, we are not going to use it. We're going to give it up and give that up. And then that led to the removal of the issue from the table. So now the opposition can use it as a threat against the Syrian regime, because if they use it as a threat to the Syrian regime, they would report it to the United Nations, and then we're going back to the previous incident where thousands, hundreds of Syrian claimed to be killed by this weapon. So it's a shrewd move by accepting it, and by accepting it, they gave some power to themselves. Now, Michael, the other issue pertaining to why it is taking them too long. Well, there is a financial issue. Who's going to pay for it? The Syrians certainly were not going to pay for any destruction. And then, as we find out, actually, you have to restore this, to put this, to find a place where to throw this chemical weapons. And countries were not happy to destroy them in their countries. There was initially discussion Germany would take some. Some other countries where we're supposed to take some. So it's finding the country that would take that waste is the problem, and that's what's taking too long. What's interesting about all of this debate about the chemical weapons is now we're reading that the Syrians actually give up those chemical weapons because they had better weapons. So whatever it is, there we have to wait and see. So if we go back, thanks, Michael, for that stop and looking at a different issue. So we were talking earlier about the video, the CNN video, and in it, it was clear that there are abuses of human rights abuses. The destructions of cities is from what we see from the satellite pictures is very sort of horrific. And and we were looking at the issue of why is it these parties could not, the two parties, the Syrian regime and the opposition, could not reach a consensus on a small issue, on a big issue that they think is very is important to both of them. They both sat the very first day or the second day and discussed it and felt that actually they had some kind of consensus. And they were pleased with themselves that they were able to reach an agreement. So the conference ended, therefore, with really no results. The American newspapers seems to take a positive. They liked what they saw. They thought, you know, finally those people actually got together and talk. But the region had a different perspective. Now, behind the scene, when we start to look at what's happening in this negotiation, we could easily see that there are some serious problem, and we should not expect miracles. The first issue, and we talked about this earlier, there is the issue of conflicting interests, and specifically the conflicting agendas. The agenda of the opposition is different from that of the Assad regime. In fact, they are against each other. They run into each other. The Syrian regime wanted the agenda of Geneva to be on terrorism, the foreign fighters to be at the height of discussion. The opposition wants a discussion on the transitional government and claim that's what Geneva One was all about. According to certain reports, independent report, and this is published these days in some independent newspapers, in fact, this idea of forming a transitional government was a big issue in Geneva too. And the Americans and the Russians made sure that they leave that the two parties understand that there has to be that the Syrian regime has to agree to form to place a transitional government or transitional entity, meaning that it was they left the Geneva too with the idea that when they go back to Syria, the regime, when they go back to Damascus and discuss it with the people of power there, those people have to agree that they establish a transitional entity to take care of the business of the country. This is what some of the opposition reported. Apparently, the Syrians did not support this. The opposition thinks that if the Syrian regime fails to implement this decision, then they would use the laws of the United Nations, namely Chapter 7, and place the whole matter in the hands of the Security Council. And at that point, the Security Council will decide whether to intervene in Syria or not, meaning that the Geneva II, the failure of the Syrian regime to implement Geneva II, specifically creating a transitional entity to take care of the business of government, would be a justification or a good reason for the Security Council to meet and decide to call on the nations to intervene in Syria. That is about the first issue, and that is actually the controversy that came out of that Geneva II. There are other problems, but I see we have some emails, and Juan wrote, how much longer will the world stay quiet about Assad's horrendous actions toward his own citizens? First the chemical weapon use, and now the demolition of cities and murders of Syrian civilians. Juan, thank you so much. That's a really good question. Unfortunately, I really don't know how long will he stay in power. But certainly, the way the Geneva II concluded, and it concluded by the idea that this meeting was not the first one, was not the last one. They would be meeting next. In fact, they're meeting February the 10th next week to go over some of the issues. This kind of negotiations could turn to be negotiation for the sake of negotiation. And it seems to me that Geneva was only about that. The Russians were forced the Syrian regime to go to Geneva, and they seem to be forcing them to accept certain decisions. And the Americans did the same thing with the opposition. Remember, this opposition has no representative inside the country. The rebels that they are fighting are not under any of their authority. So it's really what you have behind it. You have these Americans who are behind the opposition, and you have the Russians who are behind the Syrian regime, and they're telling them, look, we want you to form this, to say, you know, we accept the formation of a transitional government. And the Syrian regime said, no, but no, you do it. And then they have these reports out there. So there is no authority, no control over those. So we have to be very careful about negotiating for the sake of negotiating. And I think the Syrian regime, this would benefit the Syrian regime. So it adds to the problem, or the answer to your question. It adds to the problem that the Syrian regime will be there for a long time. Then there is another reality, Juan. The fact that up to now, the strongest player in the Syrian conflict, sadly enough, is the Syrian regime. This is by the conclusion of the British intelligence. This is by the conclusion of the American intelligence. So in a sense, they have the upper hand, and they proved it. I mean, the way the Muallim, the foreign minister, I believe, of the Syrian regime, talked to Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary General of the United Nations, is sort of, you know, it tells you that they really have a chip on their shoulder. So I don't think that the Syrian regime, despite where you are, where position you stand, whether you're for or against it, and I know Los Angeles, there are people of different political views, and if you believe it's conspiracy, it's whatever you believe in, the fact is, it remains that the Syrian regime and Bashar al-Assad, the president, has failed to connect with his people, missed a lot of opportunities to connect with his people, and this latest negotiations, the way they handled the negotiation, is another indicator that they're really, really not into giving any power or whatsoever. They are convinced that if instability continues the way it is, they will buy time for themselves by making themselves the institution that would protect the interests of outsiders, the United States, or even the region going into instability. So the chaos, the anarchy that exists, and the fact that the opposition continue to be really a pathetic opposition, the fact that it continues to be narrowing its vision and failing to connect with the Syrian people, all these facts help the Syrian regime, Bashar al-Assad, the president that you've seen in the picture, to continue to prolong his existence in the regime. And again, these are observations that we could see from how the Syrian leadership have acted, and how they've been sort of have been sort of at fault here for continuing to ignore the violation of human rights, to ignore the suffering of many people inside Syria. Let's move to Marcet. Hi, Marcet. I hope you're doing well. And thank you so much for the question. The United States has a history of invading and overthrowing political Arab leaders in the past. Do you think the United States is hesitant about invading Syria and overthrowing its president because it might lead to conflict with Russia? Well, there is, in fact, Marcet, that connection the interests of the United States and those of Syria and those of Russia are different. And the key point that I made earlier is that both countries are sort of using Russia and the opposition. Using Syria and the opposition as really in their control, using them to their own advantages. So if United States is to intervene, it has to get the approval of the Russians. But what we know about Russia is that Russians tend to do a lot of talks, but not the walk. Is Syria different? I don't know. But from the past in Iraq, from the past in Libya, the Russians have, sometimes again, came out opposing the United States position. In Iraq, they took what many anti-war groups believed as a strong position. They were against the war from the start, when it mattered the most, vetoing a United Nations resolution or objecting and preempting any strikes against Iraq. They didn't do that. What later on we find out that actually they are more into dealing and they go after their own interests like any nation. So the point is this: the Russian, America, and the United States have interest in the region, and the United States would not go to Syria, intervene in Syria without some kind of blessing or agreement with the Russians. That agreement could be in form of threat. The United States could tell Russia, look, if you do this, if you are going to go against me, no more economic economic aid, no more privileged treatment, and we are going to continue to play hardball in Europe. They could also tell them, look, if you help us here, we could help you there. So there are a lot of linkages that they could work. So from that perspective, there is that that idea. But in terms of why they didn't intervene, I think it has to do a bit, and I should say a lot, with the fatigue, with the public opinion. The Americans, like the Europeans, are fed up with these wars, and for good reasons. I mean, we spent billions and billions of dollars on this war only to see our economy going down the drain. Just as a sample, I mean, before the Iraq war, the gallon of gas was less than $2. I mean, it was even at one point, what is it, $1.15, $1.20. That's not a long time ago. That was before the Iraq war. We were told we're going to intervene in Iraq to actually provide oil and guarantee the flow of oils. Well, it went up to $5, and in certain places, over $5. So the point is, you know, the wars are bad by nature, and they have consequences. And I think the American people are fed up with that kind of policy. And the third reason is that perhaps has to do with President Barack Obama, that he understood that intervening in Iraq, in Syria, could be detrimental to America's national interest. It could drive the United States into the conflict for years and years to come. Remember Iraq? I mean, this is the war that we thought will go there. Well, the Iraqi was to receive us with roses. And then what else they do? We invade them, we finish, we do the job quickly, and then we go, the next step is, shall we go to Iran, Tehran, or shall we go to Baghdad, Damascus, Syria? That was actually the discussion that was going on in the mind of the American defense strategist, that United States would, under George W. Bush, would implement would pursue an aggressive policy against the countries of Iraq, Syria, and Iran. Years later, Barack Obama is faced with a similar choice, and perhaps for good reasons, he thought best not to intervene. And I think the biggest thing that was going on in his mind was, oh boy, we were here before, I'm not going to intervene, because the situation in Syria was that bad and that difficult to handle. Thank you, Marcel, for the question. It's a good one. It brings us back to home, and we could see the picture of Barack Obama on there. It's a fun one. I haven't seen that one, and they took it away. Okay. That means go back to the questions. We're going back to the question. Rally, thanks for the for your contribution. Rally writes, what portion of the population does the official opposition to the Syrian government represent? What role does the Kurdish minority play in Syrian conflict? It's hard to, I think we started this earlier last week when we talked about the nature of the Syrian conflict. Is this a conflict that is rooted in nationalism, in ethnicity, or is it rooted in regional interest? The certainly one thing you could say about the population, this regime support among the population, the regime has lost credibility among many segments of the society. Its credibility is among the Alawite, those people who are of the same religious belief as the president. So the ethnic factor the ethnicity is a factor here. The vast majority, the Sunni population, which represent the majority of the Syrian population, is against the regime, or most of them are against the regime. He doesn't have that much support. You have minorities, and minorities is a very, very tricky question, because in the past, the minorities were very much supported by the Assad regime. The Assad treated the minority nicer than any other leader in the Arab world because they connected with them. They are a minority. In addition, the Syrian regime entered an alliance with the minorities, and it's an alliance that benefited both parties. Some of the minorities are upset at the regime, and they don't see themselves as supporters of the regime. So from that perspective, it's hard to say. It is hard to find a lot of people supporting the regime. The Kurdish population is very, very interesting. The Kurdish area, the northern area of Syria, is already sort of has its own hand, control of its population. And they have some issues there. We'll have a guest, a Kurdish friend of mine, who might come and help us understand the Kurdish politics. But for now, they are taking this as an opportunity to impose once again their identity and to probably get something out of it, some kind of autonomy from the Syrian. Of course, they have a major problems with Turkey. And it may be very, very difficult for them to join the Kurdish state in Iraq. So the Kurds are in a very fortunate position. They are using this to their own advantage. And the government so far, the best they could describe it is they haven't gotten to them yet. But we'll have to wait. But there are some serious there is a serious conflict there. Oh, Amber, welcome to the program, and thanks for the question. Amber writes, what would be the purpose of a transitional body if the opposition is bitterly divided? It seems destined to fail. It's really, that's the answer. You have the answer there, Amber. I think the idea, when this idea came out back a year ago, the idea was accepted because the Syrian regime led by Bashar al-Assad in 2013 had plans to hold elections in 2014. So they were going to have elections no matter what. We don't know if those elections are going to happen or not. So they agreed to the idea that we'll have a transitional government, but what kind of transitional government we're working? So they made sure it doesn't, the definition, the identification of what role, how it's formed, this transitional government was unclear. The opposition, on the other hand, so this is a good opportunity actually to push for the idea of having a transitional government, knowing only too well that they have their own problems. They could not get together to form a united bloc and attend on the United Bloc in Geneva as a unit. They could not even do that. In fact, there were more scrimmages, fights among themselves than the fights they have in Geneva too. So the opposition, as I said earlier, is really a pathetic opposition. And I know there are some people out there who think that this is not a proper way of describing them. But when you look at the big picture, what it takes with the problems that the Syrian people are going through, that is really what's happening in Syria. So in a sense, this opposition is now, a year ago, when this idea of having, less than a year ago, of having a transitional government, it was really a lifesaver for them. We're going to push for it. The government will obey by it. And that's what's going to happen. So they met in Geneva, and they came up with the strangest idea with no definition, with no clear understanding of how this will form. They leave with their own assumptions that, well, we get something. We get them next year. Next year they are going to have this transitional government, and this is how we're going to do it. And transitional government means that the Bashar Assad will not be in that government, that there will be different states. Of course, the Syrian regime did not agree to that. In the meantime, the facts were being sort of dictated on the ground, that the Nusra, the Islamist radical organization, was taking control of some part of the country. The Daesh, the Islamic State of Iraq and Sham, were doing sort of fighting the Syrian army to the point where now the opposition was fighting the terrorists, Al-Qaeda. Good article today in Los Angeles Times about that. So this opposition, instead of fighting for the independence, find themselves fighting other groups. So they were outplayed, outmaneuvered, and lost in major, in more ways than one, the battlefield. So it is a very, very interesting predicament. And to see them playing a role other than, you know, being a problem more than a solution is really difficult to imagine. Hey, thank you, Amber, for asking the question. Always smart, and we'll see you soon. Maria, there is an article I read in which Kerry states, we call on Assad to live up to his obligations, or we will join our friends and determine options to move forward. What will happen if Syria can't solve this? Thanks, Maria. This is a really good question. Hold on a second. Don't delete it. I need to see it again. I need to look at some of the stuff. If we get a chance to see the questions, it's better. If not, I think I remember a little bit about the question. Maria's point is that we call on Assad to live up to his obligation, or we will join our friends and determine options to move forward. I think what Kerry is suggesting here, and I think it's a statement just recently, what he's talking about here is that he wants Assad to live up to his expectation, but what kind of obligations? Assad would come and may say, look, I fulfilled all expectations. The only expectation I have is for my Syrian people, and I'm a sovereign state. But what is behind the question, what is behind this Kerry's observation, is he's indirectly telling Bashar that if you leave us with few options, that if you don't, for example, meet our expectation that you come, for example, to Geneva to negotiation, because initially they were not against, they were against it. If, for example, you don't come through, and I'm just giving an example with the nuclear, the chemical weapons deal, that you need to give us all the information, then we are left with the option of going back and arm the opposition. Remember, until this point, the opposition has not, the United States has yet to trust the opposition 100%. But there is one thing that is on the table there, and I think that's what is pushing the Syrians to do, the Syrian regime to do, whether it's sort of going to Geneva, plus the idea of the Russians pressuring them, and then the public relations. The Syrians are very, very careful. The regime is very, very careful about being portrayed in the media as the bad guys. They want to play on that image. They want to show that they could do better. They want to show that their fight is against terrorism, and they want a platform to spread that message. So the Syrians are very clever about this. But what the United States has is there is always this discussion about creating a no-fly zone. Creating a no-fly zone, this happened in Iraq. Remember, just after the Iraq War, the United States, and along with the Security Council, made sure that no airplanes, Iraqi planes will fly in the sky. So the all the military air force of Iraq was preempted from flying. Now, there are discussions, and we'll come back to this another time, that the United Nations was not clear about this, because when 16 of the 18 provinces rose against Saddam in 1991, that is, and they were about to get rid of the entire regime. These are revolutions. This would be like an Arab Spring in Iraq. When those things happened, guess what? The Americans, the British, the United Nations Security Forces allowed the Iraqi president, Saddam Hussein, to use helicopters to end the revolts, particularly the Shia revolts in the south. And when asked why the no-fly zone was not implemented at this point, the answer was, well, helicopters were not included. The point is this: what the United States has in Syria today is that leverage. They could actually, if the United Nations want to do it, they could go to and issue a United Nations Council resolution banning the Syrian regime from flying anywhere in the air. And if they choose to do so, they would be in violation of the United Nations Security Council resolution. And as such, they would be attacked by the United Nations Security Council forces. That what my Kerry might be talking about, that if you force us, if you don't deal with us, we may resort to action that may not be in your favor. Thank you so much, Maria. It's always good to read your questions, and I'm glad you contribute in, and it's a good question. Christina, Syrian foreign minister Muallim stated there have been no tangible results, partly due to U.S. blatant interference and negative atmosphere that was created. What was he referring to? Well, and that's our 800 number. If you want to call us with a question, please do so, or you could email us and with that email, and we'll be glad to answer that. So the issue that we are discussing is the Syrian conference. And we looked at it from a different perspective. The first perspective was we talked about this last week, what kind of conflict we are doing. And in this first hour, we looked at the Geneva conference, why it failed, and how did the parties react to it, what are the interests the United States has, what are the gains between the Russians and the United States. So what I'm going to do is, Christina's questions requires a little bit of depth. I am going to leave it in after the break. And when we come back, We'll talk about Maria's, I'm sorry, about Christina's question, which basically really puts us in a deals with how the media, the blame game, contributed to the failure of this conference. So we talk a little bit about the environment that surrounded these negotiations and why that bad environment contributed to its failure, whether the Syrian regime spokesperson, Muallim, or foreign minister said it, or the other parties said it. So we'll take a break now. When we come back, we'll pick up with Christina. We'll talk a little bit about, we will talk about Tunisia, and hopefully we'll end up with other topic as well, violence in the Middle East and President Barack Obama expected visit to Saudi Arabia. Please come back.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Grant Wagner, and I'm a teacher here at Menachie High School. And I've had the good fortune to be involved with the Young Scholar Program through CSU Dominguez Hills for over 10 years. We have encouraged our kids to take on this opportunity, this challenge, for various reasons. One, it allows our students, for a very nominal fee, $3.50 for a college class, to experience what college is going to be like.
What I like best about the program is how it fits to your schedule. Like, you can watch the lectures whenever is convenient for you, and it's really easy to talk to the professors.
And these students, whether they pass or fail, are learning some valuable lessons about what it's like to be a college student.
The thing I like best about the courses I take through the Young Scholar Program is the difficulty of the courses. A lot of people think that they're easy to take, but they're actually pretty difficult, and they challenge you and they really make you think, and that's how college is going to be. So it really prepares you for college.
This program is really an incentive for students that have a 3.0 grade point average and are ready to face the rigors of the college environment.
I encourage students to enroll in the Young Scholar Program at California State University of Dominguez Hills because of the advantages they have when they leave high school. They have college credit at an incredible value.
What Dominguez Hills is to me is actually just a great learning environment for me because of the Young Scholars Program. It's really helped me just know a lot more about marine biology and astronomy, and currently just like logic and just the individual in society. It's just all great classes, and it's really nice to like use something that you don't really learn in high school, get outside information from Dominguez Hills, and just apply that to the outside world.
This series of classes allows our high school students, it empowers them to solve their own problems. And the Young Scholar Program allows the kids to do that. Thank you.
I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
Now this is student life.
I'm home right now, but...
Sweet!
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Politics of the Middle East. This is our second week, and we are discussing our current event topics, the Syrian conflict, and we talked about the Geneva II conference, a conference that some depicted as a failure, and others saw as a step perhaps in the right directions, what Los Angeles Times described as a mute optimism. We looked at in the first hour at the interests and the influence of the Russians, the Americans. We looked at also at the nature of the opposition, how strong is this opposition, and why, or how weak is the opposition, and why this opposition has so far played a minimal role in resolving the conflict. We also made a point that however we look at this conflict, and the fact that the humanitarian issue continues to be a problem, the populations, the Syrian people, are trapped in the middle, and as such, there is a war against the civilian, and to depict the conflict as a civilian conflict is really misleading, because the Syrian people are being affected. So it's a war against the civilians more than a civil war. And we ended up by reading Christina's question, which, and they also have another question, Nital, about United States involvement in this conflict, whether it should get involved or not. But let's begin with Christina. Christina, to remind our viewers, wrote, Syrian Foreign Minister Muallim stated there have been no tangible results, partly due to U.S. blatant interference and negative atmosphere that was created. What was he referring to? He was referring to so many things. I mean, United States, John Kerry, the Secretary of State, played a major role in getting these parties together. Kerry and the State Department were behind the assembling of the opposition. The opposition categorically refused to attend because of the obvious problem. Despite this conversation, what we read in the press, and what the people have come to sort of look at, that the condition to attend Geneva II, the opposition made it clear they will only attend if the regime agrees to disband, namely to give up power. There was no point, no indication that Bashar al-Assad would take on that approach, that they would come to Geneva with the idea, look, I give up. It's I had enough. I'm out, or I'm defeated. Forgive me. No. they were very strong, continue to be strong, and the opposition understood that very well. They understood this will be a failure. But doing so, not attending the summit, the Geneva conference, would have been really a big blow to the United States, John Kerry's efforts. So the Kerry lobbied very, very heavily to get the opposition to get there, to attend the conference. The same thing, he lobbied the Russians to make sure they put pressure on the Syrians. And there, the Russians are entangled in another conflict, just to do some linkages. Those of you who are in the class could, for example, look at what's happening in Ukraine today. The Ukraine is a major country in Europe. And the Ukraine is historically has had links to the Russians. And in fact, the country is a bit divided among those who have allegiances to the Russians and those who have allegiances to the Europeans. The Ukraine there are major demonstrations there because of an attempt of the Russians to place it under its wing. The president had refused European aid in billions of dollars to help his economy. A bit will take forever to get that aid. Refused also an offer from the European to integrate them in the future or to start the process of integrating Ukraine and a longer term. So these vague offers plus an aid that was not really that much of an aid. The president of the Ukraine refused that and accepted a Russian deal, a better deal for economic aid, cheaper prices, oil prices, and Ukraine doesn't need that. But the country, some people or a lot of people were unhappy with that. It meant for the Ukraine, either it meant an identity or a shift of their identity, meaning that if they go, if they accept the European Union deal, that means they are locked to become to have their identity entrenched in Europe. If they accept the deal with the Russians, it means that they are going to be Russians or along the Russian orbit. So if you are United States, John Kerry, and you know what Russia wants, you may want to deal on this issue. I give you some here, you give me there, and so on and so forth. So the point is this, is that you have this major countries, the two countries, United States and Russia, who have interest, and they are going to use it to their own advantage. So Kerry's, to answer your question, Christina, would also put pressure on the Russians to put pressure on the Syrian regime to accept the deal, to accept at least negotiate. So the United States has a lot of leverage, and when Muallim said that, he has inside information, and he's right in suggesting that the United States is intervening, and it's making the matters perhaps worse, or from his perspective is worse. We could see it as worse, but that's a different point, and I don't have an answer for it. Thanks, Christina, for the question. Let me read a question that Nital sent me to my email box. Nital, make sure to send it to this program. Thank you. Nital wrote, do you think the United States should get involved in Syria? And if so, to what extent? Actually, that's a question we may pose to our listener, to our viewers. Should the United States intervene in Syria? I mean, we heard from the President Barack Obama when left it to the Congress to decide. Likely, we were sort of protected. We were sort of, they give him a lifesaver when the Russians said, yeah, maybe we negotiate the deal for nuclear chemical weapons. But should United States intervene in Syria? It's been, there are some groups that want that to happen. Just to answer your question, I don't think we should. I think the decision that was made a long time ago, it was made for us, was the right one. I don't believe that the countries can achieve their interest, can serve their national interests in today's work by going to war. And if they go to war, as we've seen, there are consequences. And the consequences, there are many, and the loss of human lives, the problems that the veterans face when they come back, all of those are just a few. They are big, but few of the problems. In today's world, I think we should use other means to resolve our problems, and certainly going to war doesn't help. Maybe that's idealistic, but that is my answer, and I would look forward to hearing other comments. Ramzi, thanks for the input. So this is what Ramzi writes. So Russia is trying to put the Ukraine under their wing like they do with Syria as a strong ally. You know, that's really a good link, Ramzi, and I like the connection. Well, in the top is the Russians are in control. This is another Russian empire. They have the Ukraine in Russia, in you know, the former Commonwealth, Soviet Commonwealth, and now they have Syria. But in Syria, you know, they have other major other interests. I mean, there is the interest, you know, gas, the military base they have there. And also, it gives Russia another place in the feeling that they are a big power in international politics. It's played to their ego. Hey, Ramzi, that's a good question. And keep reading on the Ukraine. Maybe you compare the Russians' foreign policy towards the Ukraine and towards Syria. It's a good way of looking at the foreign policies of that country. Let me conclude by adding a few more points to the Syrian conflicts before we move to Tunisia. But if you have a question, please call us on that number. And if you have an email, if you prefer and you're watching us on the internet, you could always use that email address and send either a question or a comment, and we'll be more than happy to read it on the air. Yeah, maybe we have an answer for you. So far, we seem to have answers. We'll see if we can live up to that challenge. And I see we have a phone call. Let me take the phone call. And Ramzi, thank you so much for the question. Hello. Who is this? Amber, hi, how are you?
Good.
Welcome to the program, Amber.
Hi,
what's your...
I actually called to comment on the question about whether the United States should intervene in Syria.
Okay.
And I have a resounding no, we should not intervene in Syria. I think it'll be a bad foreign policy decision. I don't think the environment on the ground in Syria is conducive to an American intervention right now. And there is no viable opposition to take over power once, in theory, we are able to militarily defeat Assad. And so I think it's a terrible decision if we decide to intervene militarily. I think we need to focus on more diplomatic means at this point.
I think those are really excellent observations, Amber. But let me ask you, there are a couple observers who are saying that why doesn't the United Nations enforce what we call the no-fly zone? If you remember, and I know you know this very well, in the Iraqi case, there was a no-fly zone, and it sort of helped neutralize the Saddam Hussein regime. Why do you think this is not happening in Syria at this juncture?
Well, I think the United States seems really reluctant to confront Russia on that issue. If we take it to the Security Council, it's going to be a moot point. It's going to get vetoed. And so I think maybe there's no political appetite to have this battle out in the Security Council right now. I think the Americans don't want to have that discussion right now. I think the Americans don't have an appetite for really anything to do with Syria outside of humanitarian relief right now. Although whether the no-fly zone is a good or bad idea is a different question.
Yeah.
But I don't think that the Obama administration really has the appetite to really fight that battle. At least at this point, they haven't sent any signal that they would go that route.
Hey, Amber, thank you so much. Those are great points. I'll talk to you soon. That was an excellent question, an excellent response, I should say, or a comment on the current, on whether the United States should intervene in Syria. And Amber has some extremely good points on that issue. I don't know if we still have one more, no, we don't have a call there, but if you want to call us, the number will appear again and again for you to call. It's a free call, phone call. It's an 800 number, but you could also use an email address to get in touch with us. Just to conclude this topic, and again, if you have a comment on that, please do what Amber did. Just to conclude, some of the issues that are sort of remain very important in discussion of any peace resolution of the Syrian conflict. Number one issue is the agenda of the negotiation. As long as we don't have a clear cut, common understanding of what is it we are negotiating, what is the end of the game? Is it to establish a transitional government, and then later on a new regime? Is it the end to end the Assad regime? Is it the end to end the presence of foreigners? As long as we don't have those, I don't think any negotiation will go far. Now, so far, what we have been doing is using the language to enter our own interpretation to enter these negotiations. So the Americans look at the agenda as being the end or the establishment of an institution that would long-term replace the Assad regime. The Syrian may not know that. So the agenda, as long as we have this agenda that is clear and clear, and led itself to confusion, we are going to have to have, we are going to continue to have a problem there. The second point, and I'll come back to Raleigh's, thank you, Raleigh, for sending me those comments, and please keep sending them if you have an interest in the Syrian conflict. So the second point, the first one is the agenda. We have to have a clear cut understanding what is the agenda of the day. And by that I mean, we want an end game. What is it that we want? Is it getting rid of Bashar? If it's getting rid of Bashar, let's talk about it. If it's establishing a transitional government to replace the existing government, let's be clear what it means. And again, so far we haven't seen that. The second one, which is very, very interesting also, is the idea of negotiation. There is no clear end in the negotiation, this negotiation. I mean, we started Geneva 1, now we're doing Geneva 2, and now we meet next week in some place in Munich or somewhere, and we seem to negotiate for the sake of negotiating. We seem to negotiate because a third party or a fourth party told us, you know, have to be there. I'm going to pay for it, by the way. I don't know about the Russians pay for the Syrians, but it's certainly we paid a lot of money for this opposition. It's a lot of money that is used for, could be used for other users. But it has to be a specific road plan for these negotiations. And the road plans are very good. They may not lead to the result that we want, but at least they give you a vision, the idea, what is at the end of this negotiation. Let's pick up the Middle East peace process, the Oslo Accord. The Oslo Accord was a terrible accord. It didn't sort of help go anywhere because it failed later on and everybody manipulated it. But it had a specific agenda, a specific road map, which stipulated, or which said clearly, that by May 1997, the negotiation started in 1993, by May 1997, would have covered these issues. The Palestinians would have up to 97% of the West Bank, and they would have Gaza, the whole Gaza, about 100% in Gaza. And what is left at that point is the issues of refugees, what to do with the refugees, what to do with Jerusalem, what to do with the nature of the states of the Palestinians, the borders. Those are the issues that were left after 1997. The point is this. the negotiation in the case of the Palestinians in Oslo had specific starting date and specific ending time. The Syrian conflict negotiation should have the same kind of parameters. We cannot just meet to negotiate for this, negotiate and renegotiate and renegotiate. There has to be a point where we say, what is this going to end? By all indication at this point, when Geneva, American optimism, particularly Los Angeles time, when saying, you know, this mute optimism, the term that they use, that deep inside, that some of the delegations were happy, but they did not want to express their optimism openly because of a fear that may give credence to the other party, the Syrian government. That assumption, or that sort of presumption of the part of the Los Angeles Times, leads to the really was also the Los, I'm sorry, Los Angeles Times also said that, you know, you have optimism, this mute optimism, but the parties agreed to negotiate again, to meet again and negotiate, but that could drag for months or years, as we've seen in other conflicts. So it's very, very important if we are serious about resolving the problem of the Syrian conflict, if we are serious about the humanitarian issues, just like the first day or the second day the participant in Geneva did, then we have to have a date. So the first one, clear agenda. The second one is specific dates when the negotiations are going to end. Before I continue with my list, let's view some of the questions or comments. Rali, thank you so much for your question. This is a comment. Oh, it's a question. Does the U.S. inconsistent or unevenly applied foreign policy, i.e. past supports of dictators, detract from the legitimacy and sincerity of the U.S. may have in participating in the negotiating with Syria? I understand the question, Rally. And basically what you're saying, the United States really has a bad record. I mean, they supported the dictators. They're the one who were behind initially Saddam Hussein, only to they dealt with him. They were it was a good body of the United States in the 80s. The United States supported Mubarak, and turns out he's a bad guy. His government overthrew him. So all this bad sort of these bad teammates that the United States or supporters or allies that the United States has had to have, might not be a good example to use to say, you know, hey, look, now we're going to try to side with the good guys in Syria. The funny thing about it is that even the Syrian opposition, I mean, you look at those people who are negotiating in Syria, in Geneva, they have no ties to Syria. The opposition, in all these cases we have seen, those who came to power and are mostly lived in the West, for obvious reason. I mean, it's tough to live there and lead a struggle. But they have been, been in the West for quite some time. So the link to the masses is very weak. So not only we have this bad history with the supporting the dictators, even at this time, when the party is clear, there are the bad guys, the government, and the opposition, we're not doing a good job at it. And we are siding with the wrong people. This doesn't mean that the current opposition in Syria are wrong. But when you look at the background of this opposition, one could raise the issue, and I know some of my Syrian friend or some people from the region could call us and straighten that up. But the point is that there is clearly this opposition is clearly has no legitimacy whatsoever in Syria. I mean, it's been supported by the outside, the fighting inside is really led by the Islamist radicals. A lot of times, the Islamist radical versus the secular opposition. And in the middle, as I said, these are the Syrian people who are being affected. So you're right, Rally. I mean, we have a problem of credibility, but we've been winging it. And we'll do more on that next week when we talk about American foreign policy. Hey, Carlos, welcome to the program. And Carlos Wright, what would it mean to the Christian minority in Syria if the rebels win? You're assuming that the rebels are Islamists or Islamist radicals or secular Democrats, and they would be against the Christian minority. When you look at the Egyptian case, that could be sort of a problematic for us. In Egypt, we really thought what came out of it, out of the Tahrir, you know, that revolution when it happened, when you saw a Christian, Muslim, a revolution that brought everyone, you know, irrespective, regardless of their religious background or ethnic background, that's what we saw in Egypt. And then what was very interesting about it, you know, there has been for years this fight between, or this conflict between the Christian Copt and the Muslims. As we know, this is a huge conflict in Egypt. Some of them, we'll talk about it another time when we get to it. But the conflict, it turns out, a lot of times when the revolutionary took over, they discovered documents showing the government's involvement. So that a lot of times the bombing, the killing of Copts or Muslims were actually done by the security forces, by the Egyptian old guard. And they were designed to create problems in the Egyptian society and politics to favor one group against the another. It was shown that when the government has a problem with the Muslim Brotherhood, they would create this conflict with the Copts and blame the Muslim Brotherhood on the other way around. The point what we learned from those experiences in Egypt, and I thought we really did, because they were made public, but suddenly, as we see today, it's tough to be a Christian in Egypt, and it's tough to be a Christian in many of the Arab world. And for that matter, it's not just for the Christian, for other minorities. And a lot of times, the Arab world has really failed the minorities in more ways than one. In Egypt, for example, prior to this constitution, luckily we haven't seen this in this constitution, but prior to this constitution, only people who were born Muslim have the right to run for certain political, for the highest position, a president or a foreign minister. Boutros Boutros-Ghali, a brilliant man, a scholar, an international law professor, who rose from the university to the foreign ministry of Egypt to become a secretary general of the United Nations. Boutros Boutros-Ghali, in his country, he could not be appointed as foreign minister of Egypt. His title was the foreign minister to the state, or minister of state in charge of foreign affairs. And the idea behind it was not because Boutros Ghali was not qualified, obviously was qualified, if the entire world of the United Nations saw him as someone who could do the job. The obvious thing was that the Egyptian constitution did not allow someone with a non-Islamic faith to be a foreign minister. This is under the old regime, so don't bring it for now because it's a different topic, but we'll talk a little bit about it another time. And at the time when when Boutros Ghali became a foreign minister, this was during the time of Sadat. Sadat had decided to visit Israel, and the foreign minister of the time resigned in protest against the visit. The second person in charge refused, and then, and with days away from visiting Israel and giving the famous speech in front of the Knesset, Anwar Sadat picked Boutros Ghali. But facing with a constitutional problem, he named him Minister of State in charge of foreign affairs. Now, maybe we are a ways from that. It's not constitutionally done. But minorities in the Arab world and in some Muslim world have had to struggle. The idea that you have to be culturally melted or melting is high prevails in many of that part of the world. It's sadly I think all religions preach to tolerance and recognizing each other as a human being. But so far, that is a problem. So to answer your question, Carlos, the Christian minority did very, very well under Bashar al-Assad. I don't know what's going to happen under a new regime. We should not. I'm assuming that whatever the outcome, good sense should prevail. Let's hope. Okay, Danny, welcome to the program. And if nothing is negotiated before elections occur this year in Syria, can the results be legitimate? How could the elections even encompass the whole population with the current conflict and displacement of refugees? It's really an excellent question, Danny, and thank you. I appreciate the comment. Number one, we really don't know if the elections are going to happen. That's one thing. And you're really, it's really right to the heart of the matter. Remember when we started this conversation, we said the president, Assad, is expected to have elections in 2014. Well, it's dead. Nobody is talking about it. I haven't seen it. Maybe I didn't do my homework as well. But there is no talk about it. Nobody is saying, you know, let's run for that elections. The obvious reason, the opposition and the security is a major, major issue. And number two, if they were to have elections, nobody knows this opposition outside. And I know, again, that there are people out there who would object to that. But when you read the reports, when you look at what this opposition is doing, it lacks any kind of credibility. So, please, if you are if you have any knowledge of those elections, just give us a call. So, Danny, you're correct. We have a problem there, a problem of, you know, are we having the elections based? Can we have the elections and then the security? And if we have them, who is going to win? Can they be legitimate? Who is going to supervise them? So it's a very, very, very interesting point. Please give us a call if you have any reaction to what we just said about Syria, namely that we have a weak opposition that has no grassroots in Syria, and you may think otherwise. That's the number for you to call. You don't have to be a student. You don't have to have any connection to Cal State Dominguez Hills. We love to have your connections and be part of our community. And you can be that by just calling us and contribute to our discussion. That's the number. An email address will come shortly if you are watching us on the internet or YouTube. Ramsey writes, one of the biggest concerns even include the capital. The Israelis want Ramallah as the capital, but the Palestinians want East Jerusalem as the capital. This is, I think, Ramzi, you're making reference to my comment that in negotiation, you have to have a start and an end date for it to get the idea that it will be successful. You're correct in a sense that the Jerusalem, the capital that both the Israelis and the Palestinians claim, although with some variation, the Palestinians have come to the idea that they want only East Jerusalem. There is a problem. The Israelis believe that Jerusalem's borders are this way, or they include certain areas, while others don't. In this case, what the Palestinians are saying, or what the Israelis are saying, fine, you want to share Jerusalem? Well, we'll give you this area. Just we call this entire area as Jerusalem. But what the Palestinians refer to is basically, they have in mind is the mosque and the holy sites in the region. That's what to them what it meant. What Israel done has expanded the borders of Israel to that of Jerusalem, and it became sort of an issue that they use to tell the Palestinians, hey, you can, if you take Abu Dis, for example, this is an area that is filled with the settlers. We can give you this settlement, and make it your, just as a hypothesis, make it your capital, you are going to still be in Jerusalem and East Jerusalem. So the question there is a lexic again. Thanks, Ramsey, for this contribution. Listen, we are going to do the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, and I wanted to bring that question, but I also wanted to do more research on that. So good question. Hey, Amber, we'll come back. If the violence in Syria continues indefinitely, what are the long-term prospects for the over 2 million refugees? Will some continue to languish in neighboring countries such as Lebanon, or will the European state develop a plan to provide asylum? It's really, really a very, very serious question, Amber, and I think you touched it there in many ways. There are huge, huge problems with the Syrian refugees. I don't know if the number 2 million is accurate, and you could get so many numbers, from so many angles. And it's, sometimes you hear 3 million, sometimes you have 7, but let's say even 2 million, that's a large number. But you have several problems with the refugees. Number one is that they are being sort of mistreated in many ways by the host government. For example, in Algeria, there are so many Syrian refugees, and a lot of them actually came to Algeria and opened a lot of businesses there. I was in Algeria just a few months ago, just last month. And you know, you walk in to a restaurant, it's owned by Syrians, you serve Syrian food. But there are some who are not lucky, particularly the women. They are sort of, the government is hosting them, giving them houses and all that stuff, and there are directives not to make sure that all their kids are enrolled in school and for free, but they endure severe problems. One of them is that the Algerian government refused to give them the status of refugees. They still treat them as hosts, as guests. And the reason for it, the Algerian government feels that if they they depict them or they describe them as refugees, then they will be entitled to certain rights from the United Nations refugee associations. And it will actually send a bad image of the Algerians, and they don't want to do that. So for political reasons, and there are other stuff, for political reasons, the Syrian refugees in Algeria are sort of being discriminated against in more ways than one. I mean, I said this times and times again. There is mistreatments of women. They don't have the jobs they want. But those who succeed, have the money, they are sort of treated nicely. Now, this is that. That's the outside of it. There is another issue with it. And within the camps, a lot of them, particularly in Jordan, a lot of Palestinians, Syrians, left to live in Palestinian refugee camps. But suddenly, that created a new social dynamics. And the social dynamics is a lot of Syrians who now flee Syria. Are well-to-do people, upper middle class with a lot of money, and usually it's people well-to-do who leave more than those who can. Those who have limited resources stay in the country, but those with means, they leave. Now, they leave Syria, goes to Jordan, they are living in a refugee camp, in a Palestinian refugee camp, where the situation, where the conditions are horrific. You cannot imagine them. And you could just do YouTube, see what refugee camps, how are they. But they come with a bourgeois attitude, if you allow my, in fact, it's a French, with a rich attitude, with an upper mentality. They want people to work for them. They expect things to be treated, to be living in a five-star hotel or whatever. They don't get that. So what it created an imbalance, a class gap, a class-based gap within these refugees. So again, it created resentment, it creates fight, and it adds more problems to the refugee camps. Plus, the resources that they used to be to come to the refugee camp, now are being shared by these people. And because they have the means to buy them, a lot of times they take resources and food or anything away from some poor refugee person who doesn't have it. So we have they have a serious of problem in those refugees camps. Would the European give them asylum? I think a good example. I don't know if they, maybe we'll scroll down to see what your other question, Amber. But in terms of providing asylum, the European providing asylums, I don't think that happened. Even the French, who have good relationship with the Syrians in the past, remember Bashar al-Assad was received as a hero in France many years ago. The relationship that France had with Syria were impeccable. And this is because the French believe, you know, that idea that the Francophone and all that stuff. But the point is this: I don't think the Europeans will provide asylums to the Syrians, or as they would or should. We in the United States, we still struggled with the Iranians. With the Iraqis. A few Iraqis were able to get citizenship. Or refugee status. So in many ways, they're really messed up, and it's a tough life, and it's a tough life for the Syrians. This is why, again, I said, and thank you, Amber, that this is a conflict against the civilians, not a civil war. I think we lost an email. Al-Shams had a question there, if I may take it, and it will be our last one. But if you please email us if you have a comment. The discussion today seems to center on the conflict in Syria, and that is our email. And also, you could call us with an 800 number, and that number is there. And if you have a comment or a question, and I would love to hear from those of you who have some kind of connection to the Syrian, to Syria or the Syrian community, to tell us a little bit about the Syrian opposition. The picture I depicted tonight for our students and for Cal State Dominguez community is that, and those who are watching us, is that this is, and again, I use the word, a pathetic opposition. This is just to get you irritated and call. An opposition that has has failed us in more ways than one, and an opposition that has no credibility. It negotiates without having any strong backers. In fact, it has no ties to internal politics in Syria. And I'm going to take Shams' comment, and then I'll come back. Hopefully we'll be able to finish by some of the what needed to resolve what we need to have in order to have a good resolution to the Syrian conflict. Shams, thank you so much for your question. Do you think military involvement of any extent by the United States in Syria could result a similar situations as Iraq and Afghanistan? I think that's really the clear line. That is what's going to happen. Any military intervention will get us in a big, big trouble. And a scenario of Iraq is likely. Afghanistan is another likelihood. That's why I think it was wise of President Barack Obama to take the diplomatic route. I think what we have at this point is to ensure that we contain the conflict, that it doesn't spread to Syria, to neighboring countries. We try to resolve some what we call important problems with the Iranians, try to get the Iranians into the Western sphere by agreeing to work with us, and use Iran to put pressure on the Syrians, work at some deals with the Russians in order to and have them put pressure on the Syrians to at least solve the humanitarian issues, open the corridors, get some food for the people in the cities. So I think that is the best option. Going to war, and I'm sure many of you agree, is really a bad solution. Let me add two other points that we need for the success of negotiations. Number three is, we talked about a clear-cut agenda. I believe we have 12 more minutes for this class. So I think we have time to finish, and I'm waiting for the to tell me how much time we have left, so I know where we are in this instance. So good, we have 10 more minutes, so we could expand a little bit on this last few points. So what I wanted to end this discussion, and we'll move on to another topic next week, American foreign policy for that matter, is to see what is the best, what are some of the best ideas, or what are some of the best practices, or what is required to have a resolution to the conflict, assuming that the parties are they are where they are now. The first one is we have to have a common agenda, a clear-cut, specific agenda of what is we are talking. Negotiations have to have an ending, and that ending must be clear. Is it establishment of a democratic state? Is it is it getting rid of Bashar? Is it the establishment of a provisionary government? All of this, when you look at what has been written, either from the published or stated by the opposition or the government, there are contradictions between the two. And more than anything else, it is not clear when they use the same term. The third point is that we really have to have a mass support. We have to have a national dialogue in Syria about the future of Syria. There has to be some kind of discussion on the national, whether under the fire of weapons, it has to be a national discussion. What is important here to point out is that the Syrian society is a very educated society. The Syrian educators were all over the Middle East for decades. They had first-class teachers. In fact, the competition at the time in the 70s, 80s was between the Egyptian teachers, who turns out to be terrible. Those who left Egypt were very, very bad, because the President Sadat at the time was not eager to send the best teachers to teach in the Arab world. He made sure to send the worst teachers. Forgive me, those Egyptians who think this is an insult, but that's really a factual thing. And from an academic perspective, and this is stated, Sadat thought that what Gamal Abdel Nasser did by sending the best teachers to the Arab world, to countries outside Egypt, to promote Arab nationalism, to Sadat was a terrible idea. So Sadat reversed that. But with the Syrian and the Iraqis and the Egyptian and the Palestinians, those were they sent very, very good teachers. Syria has a huge history, a huge long established political institutions, and a very well educated population at all levels. Everyone agrees that the system was terrible. But the system did one thing: educate the Syrian people. And that education, to me, should be used at this time. That's why we have to have a national dialogue, a dialogue that will dictate, or that will show, what is the Syrian people want. And again, going back to the theme that we tried to talk about today, is the idea that, you know, we use the word civil war without thinking about it. Well, civil war involved factions, I mean, fighting each other, with civilian fighting each other. No, this is not civilian fighting each other. This is for Al-Qaeda, regime forces, rebels coming from whatever, fighting areas, killing people, bombing civilian places. I mean, we've seen the photos. So we need to have a national dialogue, a dialogue that will solve will bring all, sort of clarify, where is Syria going, where should it go. And then the other one is the idea of this Islamist radical groups that that are sort of now becoming a place for the refuge for the for them. Al-Qaeda today has thousands of fighters, according to certain reports. Nusra changed its ideology just to fight in Syria. For years, we Al-Qaeda told us that, you know, we have this enemy, and the enemy is the United States, and we're going to fight the United States, we're going to fight the Soviet Union in Afghanistan, as we did, and as soon as we get rid of it, we come back and fight the domestic, what we call it, near enemy. But in the case of Syria, for the first time we see regimes, this extremists, these radicals, fighting governments in place. By Islamic standards, the Wahhabis, for example, this is a Salafist group that are sort of preach violence, and again we can talk about this another time. Preach violence. They adhere to the belief that they don't fight. The religion banned them from rising against a ruler that provide them with certain kind of religious or institution to practice their religion. That the Wahhabis, for example, in Saudi Arabia, don't fight the monarchy. Don't fight the monarchy because they believe that the monarchy provided them with all religious place to practice their religion, and so they have no need to fight. That kind of belief, when you look at these religious groups supported by the Saudis, why is it the practice in Saudi Arabia? Why is it these groups do something in Saudi Arabia and do other things in Syria? Why are they fighting, actively engaged against the regime in Syria and not in Saudi Arabia? Which leads me to this point, that in order to have a clear, in order to reach a consensus or a result to this conflict, you have to address the foreign presence. Certainly, these foreign fighters, Al-Qaeda, and Los Angeles Times has this, are supported by the Saudis, are supported by the Qataris, but they are also supported by Assad, the regime itself. And the theory behind it, if we create a situation of instability, if we create disorder, the government became, the Assad regime, the military government will become the most viable option to maintain whatever authority is. The deal behind bringing foreign fighters from Chechnya, from all over the world, was to create a situation in which it will make the government relevant. And as such, today, the Assad regime is relevant, is seen as a relevant regime. So the point there, again, if you want to reach a good solution, a final solution to this conflict, you have to address the presence of foreign fighters, not just being terrorists supported by one group or another, but as a presence that contributes to the chaos in the country. Well, we come to the end of our show today. We talked about the conflict in Syria. We are going to come back to it sometimes, but next week we are going to look at United States foreign policy in the region. We are going to look at, for example, the current Barack Obama's administration, how it approached the Arab Spring, how the previous administration, George W. Bush, pushed for the implementation, encouraged the Arab leaders to an institution to democratize, only later to renegade against them. So, in that perspective, we are going to do sort of a survey of what went right, what went wrong, and we'll end up by giving an assessment of American foreign policy in the region. My hope is we'll have a guest, but if we don't have a guest, I think we're doing very well. You send questions, we read them, I answer them. You might believe me, might not believe me, but I welcome your views. This is Carl State Dominguez Hills. This is Politics of the Middle East. And until next week, please keep studying and keep watching. Bye-bye.